Good morning and welcome to Parkway Hills United Methodist Church. This is the second Sunday of Advent and we welcome everyone as you join us to walk through this season of waiting, this season of preparation as we make room in our hearts and minds to receive the Christ child. My name is Reverend Dawn Douglas Flowers and I serve at Parkway Hills United Methodist Church in Madison, Mississippi. And it is my joy to join with you in this time. I give thanks that you are making space in your day to join us in this place. If you're looking for a church home to walk through this meaningful season of the church, if you're looking to learn more about what the season of Advent is, what it means for the church, we would love for you to make contact with us. Reach out to me. I'd love to be in conversation with you, not only about Parkway Hills as a church family, but also about this wonderful season that is part of our faith tradition. Parkway Hills friends, you should have received in the mail a at-home devotional for the week that has prayers, questions for reflection, scripture you can read, even some just for fun things that you can do to live into this season. If you have not received one, or if you're watching and you would like one, just let us know and we will be happy to put one in the mail. In the middle, there is a calendar of all the events going on within the life of our church. Obviously, with COVID cases being what they are, we'll just have to take things week by week, knowing that some of our schedule may change because our first priority is to stay safe, to stay connected, and to serve the vulnerable. This is the day that we gather at the table of our Lord to celebrate communion, and you'll hear more information about that later when we lift up our liturgy and prepare for that moment. But part of that will be our curbside communion offering. You can drive through anytime from 11 to noon today, receive communion and prayer, and be a part of that gift of grace today. But now, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Let us go to God in prayer. God of hope, you are ever near. We enter this time of worship praying for peace. May your word ring out from the mountains and your spirit shine forth in the earth. Help us to lay aside the burdens of the day and rest in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, our strength and our salvation. Amen. Thank you.
comfort within the story of our faith. We reach to you in hope, our God.
It is hard in these days to have hope, to invest in things we do not understand, to believe in things we have not experienced, to trust that all will be well.
But you, O God, are a keeper of promises. You promised to create people, and you did. You promised a Savior, and you dwelt among us. You promised forgiveness, and you give it.
We grasp for you in hope. We await your return with expectation. We look to the renewal of all things with joy. We prepare for you through acts of love.
We lift our voices to you, seeking comfort within the story of our faith. We reach to you in hope, our God. Your promise to be fulfilled.
Come, thou long-expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our sins and fears, release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Hope of all the earth thou art. This hymn is one of the 6,000 hymns written by Charles Wesley, brother of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement. It is a perfect Advent hymn. It reminds us that this season of wreaths and candles and Christmas trees, well, it's a season of waiting, of naming the longing, of saying, how long, O Lord, how long? Last week, Reverend Philip Messner began our Advent journey by jumping straight in with the Christmas hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful. Sing, choirs of angels, was our refrain. Sing in exaltation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. We acknowledged that 2020 has been full of so much loss, music just being one of the many losses. And that we are ready for some good news, ready for some celebration, ready for some comfort and hope. But today, well, we kind of take a few steps back. If we hold, come all ye faithful in one hand, and then come thou long expected Jesus in the other, we are reminded that the season of Advent, well, it does hold two things for us at the same time. O come, all ye faithful, with its refrain, O come, let us adore him. Well, it reminds us that God has been birthed among us. God's kingdom work has begun in Christ on earth as it is in heaven. It's here, it's now, it's worth celebrating. But on the other hand, we have come, thou long expected Jesus, and we name that we are a people waiting for Christ to return and for all to be made right, for all that is broken to be mended, for all to be redeemed and made whole. It is the time to name the now and the not yet of our faith. But most importantly, it is a season of hope. There are many churches and many denominations that right now have pulled one of these out, an Advent wreath with 5 candles. You'll see purple or 3 purple and 1 pink, or 3 blue and 1 pink, or as we have, 4 purple. A white sits in the middle as the Christ candle. And each week, we light a candle, we lift words telling the story of our faith, and we walk. We walk this season together, counting down the days. Now, Parkway Hills, we made the move last year from purple and pink to blue candles. And a lot of churches for the past, 10, 20 years have been doing this, kind of transitioning away from the penitential purple that reminds us of Lent and moving to this color blue. And blue holds two things for us. We can think of the sadness that comes when we say, we're feeling blue, but also this hope, this expectancy. And Advent, well, it is a season of hope, of spiritual preparedness, of waiting the unexpected, of finding God in unexpected ways, of waiting for light and life to be birthed among us. Advent is hope in the darkness. Author Diana Butler Bass, well, she puts it this way. Blue candles symbolize the color of the sky right before morning. That time when the deepest dark is just infused with hints of light. Blue holds the promise that the sun will rise, and that even after the bleakest, coldest, longest night, the light will break forth as a new day arrives. Blue is the color of hope. Come, thou long expected Jesus, from our sins and fears release us. Now thy gracious kingdom bring. Hope of all the earth thou art. When we sat down at Parkway Hills a few months ago to think and pray and discern about how our Advent and Christmas worship should look this year, what it was people needed, what it was we could offer, comfort and hope was all that came to mind. So we decided to focus on all things Christmas. Things Christmas that give us comfort and hope. Carols and cookies and cards. And we have incorporated these things into our Advent and Christmas plans at Parkway Hills in a bunch of different ways. You can read through your, Advent and Christmas devotional to find all those things in here. So take time to look for those things and see how you can live into the comfort and hope of Christmas. The staff, as part of this, was also asked to choose one line from one of their favorite carols as to guide our worship each week. Phillips was last week with Singing Choirs of Angels, and this one is mine. From Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, hope of all the earth thou art. Now let me tell you about a practice that is part of our confirmation class each year to kind of share why this was my line of all the lines I could have chosen. We just finished confirmation for 10 of our students last week, and throughout the 3 months of confirmation, and any time we offer confirmation at Parkway Hills, parents take turns coming in and sharing with the confirmants the answers to 4 questions. Now, there's a couple of reasons for this. One is so that parents and confirmants can see each other's faces, hear each other's names, get to know each other. And it's also so the confirmants can hear someone else share and talk about their faith. So parents take turns coming in. And my son, my middle child, well, he was part of confirmation this year, so I had to share. And one of the four questions that we have to answer is, why is the church part of your story? And this line from Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, well, it was part of my answer. My answer to why is the church part of your story? Well, Hope of all the earth thou art. The church is part of my story because in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, I am told that the way things are is not the way things have to be. In Jesus, I see redemption and reconciliation and life bursting from the tomb. In Jesus, I see a better way. In Jesus, I see hope. And in Jesus, I hear God is not done with us yet. Now, this doesn't mean that the longing is gone for me, that I never say, "How long, O Lord, how long?" It doesn't mean that the trouble disappears. It means that lifting this song, singing these words from our sins and fears, release us, let us find our rest in thee. Well, it has meaning for me. I trust that I am heard and seen and loved in the midst of it all. And that, well, it gives me comfort and hope to walk through all the other stuff. There's a theologian that said, Advent is a kind of comfort food. It's the season that allows us to bring our longings, our fears, our sins, our struggles, our darkness, and in hope release them to the one who promises deliverance. This theologian went on to say that in every congregation on an Advent Sunday, there is darkness haunting the lives of at least some of those who gather. This is true for all of us who gather together virtually today. Come, thou long expected Jesus. Well, it invites us to name our darkness, to name our fears, to name our sins, to name the burdens that weigh us down, to reflect on what it means to be free, to ask ourselves, what rest do we need? And all these questions, they're not just for us as individuals, but we lift and raise them for our community and for our world as well. These are the questions of Advent. And Advent 2020, well, it leaves a lot to be named. In the midst of these longings, these Advent questions, the comfort food that Advent offers year after year, well, it reminds us that the light of God's grace still offers a flicker of hope that can guide the way. Or as one pastor said, basking in the light of God's presence and crying out for more peace, it must be Advent. There's a Lutheran minister and professor, Joseph Sittler. Well, he held this longing and this hope together once when he said, "Honesty compels us to admit that the track record of humanity, well, it's very grim. There is no excuse for chirpy hopefulness." But then he added, "But I regularly plant trees." It seems, as "Come Thou Long Expected Jesus" suggests, that against all evidence to the contrary, Christians hope. Or, to put it another way, there's a Jesuit priest, Daniel Berrigan. He has this work called Advent Credo, in his work, Testimony, the Word Made Flesh. And this is what he shared. "It is not true that creation and the human family are doomed to destruction and loss. This is true. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. It is not true that we must accept inhumanity and discrimination, hunger and poverty, death and destruction. This is true. I have come that they may have life, and that abundantly. It is not true that violence and hatred should have the last word, and that war and destruction rule forever. This is true. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. It is not true that we are simply victims of the powers of evil who seek to rule the world. This is true. To me is given authority in heaven and on earth, and lo, I am with you, even until the end of the world. It is not true that we have to wait for those who are especially gifted, who are the prophets of the church, before we can be peacemakers. This is true. I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall have dreams. Advent holds all of this for us. Our story of faith holds all of this. We see it over and over again in Scripture, this longing and hope, this, oh, come all ye faithful in one hand, and come thou long expected Jesus in the other. In the first chapter of the prophet Isaiah, we were given a scene of unbroken gloom and doom. The judgment of God against Judah for their wickedness and injustice, well, it's described in this chapter in excruciating detail. The cities are laid bare, vineyards are uprooted, princes are dethroned. The end of chapter 1 of the book of Isaiah, well, it's smoky, dark, and wretched. And then a new chapter begins. It's a fresh start. And it describes the universal reach of God's gracious actions. There's a peace that transforms the world, a hope of all the earth thou art. Basking in the light of God's presence and crying out for more peace, it must be Advent.
There's a day coming when the mountain of God's house will be the mountain, solid, towering over all mountains. All nations will river toward it. People from all over set out for it. They'll say, come, let's climb God's mountain, go to the house of the God of Jacob. God will show us the way God works, so we can live the way we're made. Zion's the source of the revelation. God's message comes from Jerusalem. God will settle things fairly between nations. God will make things right between many peoples. They'll turn their swords into shovels, their spears into hoes. No more will nation fight against nation. They won't play war anymore.
Thank you.
Through Jesus, we know that God knows us, cherishes us, and loves us. Through Jesus, we believe and trust that God is faithful and true. Today, we get to come to the table of grace. And we come to this table not because we must, but because we may. Not because we are worthy, but because we are hungry. Not because we are ready, but because we are thirsty. We come because Christ invites us, saying, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." And Jesus took bread and wine and gave thanks before sharing it. So we also give thanks to God. Holy One, Holy Three, Spirit, Son, and Father, you unfolded time and space. You created us to love and be loved, to live on this earth, intended for your glory. With all our heart, we praise you and thank you. Holy One, Holy Three, Author, Word, and Breath, you chose your covenant people and revealed yourself as holy, incomparable, and elusive, as liberator, judge, and compassionate, forgiving love. With all our heart, we praise you and thank you. Holy One, Holy Three, Lover, Beloved, and Energy of Love, you became human in Jesus, whose love goes beyond our limits, reaching out to all and calling us to practice peace, mercy, and kindness, to forgive as we have been forgiven, and to love even our enemies. With all our heart, we praise you and thank you. Holy One, Holy Three, Giver, Given, and Gifting, as we share this bread and cup, we remember how Jesus died for us, bore our sins in his body on the tree, defeated the powers of this age, and lives among us here and now, breaking our dividing walls and giving us good news. With all our heart, we praise you and thank you. Holy Spirit, power and presence of Holy Three, Holy One, make this bread and cup our communion in the body and blood of Christ. With all our heart, we praise you and thank you. Holy One, Holy Three, this day we pray for all those in need, in mind, body, and spirit, and we pause to lift the names of those that we hold in love. O God, who in love hears our prayers, receive all of this into your loving arms of grace. And now, with all your people, we join together as we say the prayer of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. If you are in the area, we would love for you to come by anytime from 11 to noon today. You can drive up to our campus and drive through and receive communion and prayer in your car. So if you're in the area and would like to come to the table, we invite you to come to Parkway Hills United Methodist Church, Madison, Mississippi, anytime from 11 to noon today. You'll also have a chance to offer a second mile giving. Every time we offer communion, we have a communion offering that goes straight to some need within our community or our world. For the month of December, this offering will go to the Methodist Children's Home here in Mississippi. It's part of their This Little Light of Mine campaign, and you can go to their website, read all about that campaign. But this annual campaign helps fund the programming for the children and families that they serve. So read about that. Come receive communion and prayer today, and give to this Second Mile giving cause. Now, I invite you to receive this benediction.
May you find time for rest this season. May you create space to prepare. May the Lord our God fill you with comfort and hope. May Jesus Christ be ever present in our heart. May the Holy Spirit illuminate your way.